Dr. John Jarecki was the pastor of a small Congregationalist church in a small town in southern Erie County, New York. The people of Springville Village welcomed him with open arms when he took over the leadership of Springville Congregationalist Church. The people in the church treated him beautifully, and John immediately fell in love with the area. The land is beautiful, rolling hills covered with woods and farms. The smell of growing crops and fragrant trees fills the air wherever you stand. He was a young man and had recently been ordained at the prestigious Quebec Theological School in Montreal. Springville Congregationalist Church was his first job, and he was in love with his flock. On this day, he was in the process of remodeling the kitchen of the former parish priest's house, a beautiful old building given to the church for the pastor and his family to live in after it ceased to be a farmer's home. The church had sold it long before John arrived, and John, having a sense of history like his older brother Paul, bought the rectory for himself. Finding that the pastor's salary was barely enough to make ends meet, he found work with August Gus D'Amiso, a local carpenter and church member. Gus had a great sense of humor, tutored John, and helped him with the house. Together they discovered that John was a born carpenter, and his attention to detail made him a great cabinet maker for a beginner. He had so much carpentry work on the side that he didn't have enough time to study and write sermons. John's brother Paul had recently moved to Springville and bought a house near John. Paul was not a carpenter, but he was an excellent cook, and he helped John with ideas for what the kitchen might look like. John and his boss Gus drew up a plan for the new kitchen with Paul's wishes in mind and got to work. When John woke up that warm summer morning, the kitchen was ready. He had hung the upper cabinet frames and the lower cabinets were already in place. All that remained was to level them before installing the countertops and hanging the cabinet doors. When John got out of bed the summer morning called to him, his wife wasn't home. She had her own plans for the day, so he was alone, taking advantage of a break from setting up his dream kitchen. Joe walked out onto the back patio and looked out over the valley behind the house. The backyard was wooded and sloped down into a ravine, at the bottom of which ran Spooner's Creek, a beautiful babbling brook by which he and his wife often made love. On such mornings, as he sipped his coffee, he replayed in his mind the last time they had met outdoors, mosquitoes aside, making love by the creek with the rising sun illuminating. His wife's smile was as close to heaven as he'd ever been in his life, and he finished his coffee and thought about calling his brother and inviting him over for a cigar to celebrate the day. But Paul was busy today too. He has work to do in his own house, and he borrowed John's milling machine to finish the new mantelpiece he was making for his fireplace in the living room. He went back to tinkering, tweaking, and checking the level in the kitchen. Every now and then he would pop into the study to complete the outline of Sunday's sermon. John labored in the kitchen until his stomach rumbled and he turned to the refrigerator. They had emptied the fridge to give it a good scrubbing, and now all they had in it was ice, diet soda, a sprout of lettuce, and a few tomatoes. The only other things in the house were white bread, peanut butter, and microwave popcorn. John turned to the microwave, but that one still should have been attached to the wall above the stove. Obviously, there was nothing for lunch in his house. He might as well go into town and get a quick bite to eat and then get back to work. John washed his face and headed out into the village. It was a beautiful day for a walk, with the sun shining through the leaves of the trees and the warm summer air cooled by a refreshingly light breeze. The village of Springville looks like it is part of a well-made model train. Beautiful old brick buildings line Main Street, home to stores with enticing storefronts, and on the outskirts of town are modern hindrances to aesthetics such as gas stations and chain drugstores where the old sawmill used to be. There is now a farmer's market in Springville's center of commerce. On a warm summer day, it amused John that many people don't recognize him when he puts on his blue jeans and work shirt. When he preaches, he always dresses as best as he can, and that is how people recognize him. John is a handsome man. Some, including his wife, would call him boyish cute. He has deep black hair, blue eyes, and a slim athletic build. He looks about 10 years younger than his actual 30 years and doesn't look old enough to be allowed to sell alcohol. So many people would be surprised to learn that he is a doctor of divinity. It was a beautiful day for a short walk into town. The Friday farmers market was in full swing with stalls selling vegetables, meats, cheeses, baked goods, handmade goods, and art. Everything looks so appetizing he should get a baguette and some cheese to snack on and maybe pick up a couple steaks for dinner. John went from counter to counter and found a French baguette on sourdough and then bought a head of his favorite goat's milk cheddar cheese. His wife loves brie, so he picked up some goat milk brie as well, then some nice ribeye steaks, some mushrooms, and a bag of tiny seed potatoes and what's for lunch. And then he heard a marvelous voice with a delightful French accent. He had studied in Montreal, and since returning to New York State, had always looked to speak French at every opportunity. He tried to locate the source of the voice, and it wasn't difficult. She was standing two stalls away from him, at the farmer's market. Tall, slender, and beautiful, she wore a light yellow sundress that contrasted perfectly with her flawless chocolate brown skin, and she carried a wicker basket filled with her purchases. He watched her move through the crowd with admiration. She was a work of art, long black hair cascading down over her shoulders, a wide, joyful smile that she shared, easily firm breasts stretching the fabric of her dress, long, perfectly sculpted legs. His mouth went dry as he marveled at her beauty. He mentally called this Nubian beauty La Femme Ohula, the Chocolate Lady. She must have sensed him, watching her as she moved from counter to counter, because she glanced over her shoulder at him from time to time. Had she really just winked at him? Then she turned suddenly and smiled at John. Bonjour. Monsieur, do you like what you see? She struck a pose. The sunlight at her back was shining through her dress, and the shadow left John in no doubt that she was not wearing underwear. When he came back to reality, she was already talking to him. Her French-Canadian accent was absolutely adorable, as was her smile. He thought of his older brother Paul, who was a doctor and was never without female companionship. He tried a line that Paul had told him was a sure trap for a girl. John coughed nervously and said, "I never do this, but it looks like I'll be alone today and I hate dining alone. Would you like to have lunch with me?" he asked. The Nubian goddess looked around the crowd and replied, "I don't know, my husband would have to meet me here." "Sive up play palais, Frank Memon. Please." "I miss the French language," he said, and then added, "Vote, mar pour and rewandre des son N.A. Your husband can join us when he arrives to parle française. Do you speak French?" She looked around, gazing into the crowd. Was she looking for her husband? She shrugged and turned to John with a dazzling smile. "Oh hey, let's have lunch." "Aye," she said in French, using the word of fame at the end. But that word had much more meaning than just starving. It could also mean hungry for sex, starving. So am I. From that moment on, they spoke exclusively in French. "You speak French?" "Well," she said with a dazzling smile, "I learned it to study in Montreal. I ended up staying there for a few years." John led her to a small cafe, where they sat in the shade of a large chestnut tree, enjoying the warm summer breeze and the smell of flowers. "I'm John Jarecki," and he held out his hand to her. She took his hand in hers, and they exchanged a handshake. "I am Marie-Claude Solange Dagana. Sometimes my friends and lovers call me Macy John Odd," the way she emphasized Le Samuraux. The lovers hit a nerve and he froze. She was beautiful, her dark skin flawless, her long wavy hair glistening in the sun and merriment dancing in her lovely brown eyes. "Voudrie-vous, new commander, would you like to order for us?" asked Marie-Claude, as the waitress approached. John didn't even notice that the waitress was standing there, waiting for him to address her. John was captivated by Marie-Claude's brilliant dark brown eyes and suddenly realized he was in a dream world. Shaking his head, he said, "We will have lemonade, excuse me. I mean, we'd like limeade, lime lemonade, and an assortment of sandwiches. Be right back." The waitress said, winking at him. A wink? Did she really know? Joe almost wanted to leave the money and disappear into the crowd for that wink, but Marie-Claude's gaze held him in place. "Lemonade. I thought the summer drink was lemonade," she said with an amused smile. "I love limeade, and when I eat Mexican food, I sprinkle salt on the rim of the glass. It goes with the limeade. Is that a non-alcoholic margarita?" she asked. "I guess so, I don't drink." Soon their order arrived, and they drank the limeade and ate small sandwiches that John promptly forgot about. They talked about life in Montreal, and he realized he was fascinated by the beauty and wit of his companion. "Are you French from the colonies, or are you French-Canadian?" he asked Marie-Claude. "I'm from Quebec," Marie-Claude replied. "My real name is Marie Tremblay, but I changed it to Marie-Claude Solange Dear." "When I became a model, John asked. His mouth went dry and his heart jumped to his throat. He shouldn't have been surprised. Not only was she stunningly beautiful, but she ate her sandwiches in tiny pieces, always watching your waiter just out of habit. "Yes, I modeled for many years in Montreal, then went to college where I met my husband. I'm originally from Lourdes de Blanc-Salon, Quebec. a tiny fishing village, so I'm no stranger to hard work and you. Mr. Jarecki, where are you from? John gestured to the north and said, over there, about 40 miles away. I come from Chictawaga. The name is an ancient word of the Tuscarora Indians. Marie Claude leaned forward, her eyes fixed on John's. What does the word Chickawaga mean? In French, it means Prix de la Porte. Marie Claude looked at John for a long time, then caught the joke and laughed a beautiful, melodious laugh that reminded John of the bells of his church. You are a funny man. John Jarecki. They talked about the differences between life in Quebec and New York. Siphon de Buffalo Bills. Il s'en fout those Buffalo Bills fans. They're crazy. Marie Claude said. P.A. Piricun fondue. Habs John said. He said they are as good as Montreal Canadiens fans, but used the Canadiens' common nickname Habitat meaning home team, but as a Canadian shortened it to Habs Sandip. Besides watching hockey, what do you like to do? Mr. John Jarecki, helping my brother with his little farm and hiking, and what do you do? I work as an assistant to a man who owns a car dealership. But mostly I'm just a simple housekeeper, she said with a wide smile. And what do you do for a living, Mr. John Jarecki? He couldn't lie. He didn't want this wonderful day with Marie Claude to end, but he had to be truthful. He pointed to an old white church a few blocks away. There was a new one being built next to it that was almost completed. I am the pastor of that church. Over there, he said in English. When Pastor Dina Fay, Marie Mary Claude smiled again, then slowly ran the tip of her tongue across her upper lip. Comme c'est délicieux. How delightful, John's breath caught. I don't know if this is the right thing to do, he said nervously. But Marie Claude's smile widened and she, absent-minded, ran her finger over his knuckles. Her touch was as soft as a feather and so sensual, I don't want this to end, he said in English, instead of pulling away. Marie Claude continued to smile and her smile grew wider and wider as she continued to run the tips of her long, slender fingers along his arm. For some reason, Marie Claude's smile reminded John of a bottlenose dolphin. They have a cute smile too, but they play with little fish and then eat little fish. Like John, she took a bite from the last remaining sandwich. It had salmon on it. How appropriate. Maybe there's a place here where we could talk privately, she asked. I have to put the groceries in the refrigerator. John replied, absent-minded. He showed her the shopping bag he kept in the shade. Yes, we have to hurry, Murray. Claude said Joe changed his mind about the dolphin as her sexy smile widened. Now he was thinking about the shark. Before John realized what was happening, they were already walking hand in hand through the shady, tree-lined streets of his small village. He was so smitten by her beauty and charm that he didn't think for a second that any of his parishioners might see them together. Soon they approached his house, built in the 19th century. He led her into the house through the front door, and she looked around how beautiful. She threw off her sandals and stood barefoot in the living room, looking around the welcoming furnishings. This room is finished. I did most of the woodwork myself, he said with a pride. He knew he shouldn't show. This fireplace is my favorite thing. The mantelpiece is a solid chestnut, a rare tree I salvaged from an old rundown mansion in downtown Buffalo. Magnifique, magnifique, she exclaimed. It was indeed a remarkable piece of work. It looked like an original fireplace from 1900. Marie Claude admired the woodwork, then walked into the kitchen and placed the basket on the table. Since there were no countertops yet, she ran her fingertips over the cabinet cases, admiring the beautiful wood. I made all the cabinets here. Look, he took two finished doors and held them up to the cabinet so she could visualize the effect of the finished product. Cielman B, it is so beautiful. He put the doors down carefully, and she took his hands in hers and said in English, such strong hands, you could do so much with those hands. Couldn't you, Jay? Say I'm trying, and his mouth went dry. Marie Claude pulled a large bread knife from a block on the kitchen table. The light played on the blade and she smiled. Let's cook something together, she said, and held the knife out to John. She found two wine glasses, a bottle of wine, and a corkscrew in the mess on the dining room table, and went out onto the back porch, leaving John alone in the kitchen. John swallowed. It's hard to swallow when your mouth and throat are so dry, but he stacked the steaks in the fridge, found paper plates, and followed her out to the back patio with the bag cheese and cutting board. There was an umbrella by the table and John opened it, giving their little patio the atmosphere of a Montreal sidewalk cafe. But without the exhaust from the buses, they ate bread and cheese in the warm sunshine, laughed about their impressions of Montreal, compared their favorite places in the City of Saints, and before John realized what he was doing, he was already sipping the wine Marie Claude had poured for him. He wanted to say, "I don't drink," but he felt dizzy. Was it the wine or from Marie Claude? He didn't want the day to end. They laughed and had fun sitting around the table, telling each other stories and sharing racy secrets. And when Marie Claude leaned forward to whisper something to him, the neckline of her dress fell open, and he could see her breasts clearly had she noticed. Finally, Marie sighed happily. "The sunlight is so warm," she stood up, hesitated, then said, "The wine is too good." John was afraid she would fall, and stood up, taking her hands to support her. She was taller than him, and he didn't know where to put his eyes. "Careful," he said. Her hands were so soft and his work hardened palms. "Such a beautiful day," she sighed as they drew closer. "It would be a sin to waste it, wouldn't it, Mr. Pastor?" Before John could answer, their lips met and they kissed a sweet, tender kiss that reflected the warm sunlight of that perfect summer day. But Marie Claude released herself from his embrace and took a step back, then reached behind her back. The dress slipped off her and fell down around her ankles. John had been right. She wasn't wearing any underwear, and she was flawless. Her chocolate-colored skin was perfection. "Let's really enjoy this day we've been given," she said, as she unbuttoned his flannel work shirt and pulled it off his arms, then pulled up his ZZZ top shirt and tossed it aside. "Come on, Mr. Pastor, show me how passionate you can be." John was no longer worried about getting caught. He had a chocolate lady in front of him begging for his touch, and he couldn't refuse her. His head was spinning, and so was hers. Neither of them could believe a day like this could happen. They reluctantly pulled away from each other, and John filled her glass and then led her upstairs to the master bedroom. The windows were wide open, and a refreshing breeze blew through them. Like all houses of that era, there was no air conditioning, but John had installed ceiling fans in every room to keep the breeze cool. Marie Claude looked at the bed and asked John, "This is the marital bed, isn't it?" "Yes," John replied, not knowing what was going to happen next, but he couldn't let the opportunity pass. "At this moment he was too engrossed. Merville les magnificent," said Marie Claude, looking at the decoration. John came up behind her and reached behind her, squeezing her breasts, sending sparks of erotic energy through her body. "Mon cher, my darling." She exhaled as he nibbled on her long chocolate neck. It felt so good she wriggled in his arms and with skillful fingers unbuckled the trembling preacher's belt and then unbuttoned his jeans. Exhausted from making love, they melted into each other's arms gently. They kissed, marveling at their discovery and ignoring the consequences. "Oh my God, that was wonderful." John breathed out as their sweaty bodies were cooled by the light summer breeze blowing through the room. "Em, you are so good. Mr. Preacher, I love your body," he replied. They pressed against each other, kissing and giggling, both glowing with bliss. "Are you ready to continue?" John asked. He wasn't quite ready himself, but he was just showing off. She wrapped her arms around him and answered, "The spirit is ready, but the body is weak. Monsieur, I'm sure that with your help." John heard something. They realized they were not alone in the house. Someone was moving around downstairs. "Didn't you lock the house?" she asked. But Jan just shrugged. "This is Springville. The only crime happens after Buffalo Bills games. Where's your Dremel tool?" John asked a man's voice from the kitchen. "Shay, that's my brother Paul," John said. Marie Claude ducked down and John pulled the blanket over her head. The door opened and a taller, more grown-up copy of John entered the room, throwing John's bright yellow sundress and tank top shirt onto the bed. "I got your bevel cutter back, but I need a Drexel tool." "Oh, hi, Macy. Bonjour, Paul," came from under the blanket. "What are you doing here?" Paul asked. "Isn't today your wedding anniversary?" We came from under the blanket, followed by a giggle. The blanket was pulled back and Macy looked up at her brother-in-law with a smile. "Yes, it is, and do you mind?" Joe asked, pulling Marie Claude, known as Macy, closer to him. "Oh no, my bad, sorry. I'll come back for the tool tomorrow." "It's in the basement, on the shelf, by the stairs," said Macy. "Thanks, honey," Paul exclaimed as she ducked under the covers. She wanted more and she was going to get a refill as soon as she stopped laughing.